Hello, my name is Willeke Wendrieg. I'm a professor of Egyptian archaeology and digital humanities at the University of California, Los Angeles. I'm also the director of the Coatesen Institute of Archaeology, and I hold a chair in African cultural archaeology. Today, as my background already suggests, I want to talk to you about Nubian basketry and especially about both ancient and historical Nubian basketry, a tradition that's still alive, but that is changing as everything is changing, of course. So without further ado, let me share my screen with you so I can also show you some pictures. And I'll move this out of the way. There we go. So my love affair with Nubian basketry started when I was invited as a student to work on excavations in what is Egyptian Nubia, this area south of Aswan, and an area now covered by Lake Nasser, of course. This is the area where Qasr Ibrahim is located. Now, Qasr Ibrahim used to be this eagle's nest, very high up on the rocks. You see it right here sticking out with a forbidding wall. There used to be a very old settlement at the foot of this mountain, Aniba. This existed already in the New Kingdom period, so 1500 BCE, before Common Era. We already know that Aniba existed. Qasr Ibrahim, this high eagle's nest, was used as a refuge originally, but gradually it became used as a center of worship. For instance, the pharaoh Taharqa, pharaoh of the 25th dynasty of Egypt, but a Nabatean king, a Nubian king, he built a big temple on this point of rock. And we have evidence of people from all over Nubia going to Qasr Ibrahim, to these temples, as pilgrims. So they actually inscribe their footprint in the sand rock around this whole area, written in Meroitic, that they were on their way to the pilgrimage. Then a cathedral was built here in the early Christian period, and there was a bishop of Qasr Ibrahim. Nowadays, Qasr Ibrahim is an island. You can still see the outline of the cathedral here. You see a whole bunch of houses. There used to be a wall going around, but with the rising of Lake Nasser, and especially the up and down of the lake, this got completely damaged and at some point collapsed. You also see a little church here. So Qasr Ibrahim was a very, very important Christian pilgrimage destination as well. So this is a picture of Qasr Ibrahim before the surrounding wall collapsed, and you see the cathedral still standing. There are nowadays only people coming there who are working there as fishermen. Archaeologists have been working there from the 1960s to the early 2000s. And cruise ships arrive off the island, but people are not allowed to go on the island because they would damage the archaeology that's still there. Now, Qasr Ibrahim is very special for a whole bunch of reasons, but one of them is the excellent preservation of all the material that is organic, textiles, leather, and basketry. So I worked here in the 19th 1990s to record the archaeological basketry. And I'll just show you some examples of those in this conversation that we're having. For instance, this beautiful saddle, probably for a donkey. It was made of date palm fiber. You see the fibers here. And if we look close up, you see the beautiful weave. So it's string that's made that is woven into this basket. You also see that it's a well-used saddle. Here it has completely rubbed off the covering stitches. And as archaeologists, we love stuff that was used, because then we can actually say something about how people use this and how people behaved, what they were doing, what they were concerned about. We also found this, a whole bunch of baskets. And maybe they don't look like much, but they do clean up quite nicely. And what strikes you immediately is that these baskets were lavishly decorated. They were either decorated with stitches here or with colored stitches, the small plates here and the large basket here. Unfortunately, the center is missing. But you see that these dark stitches are used to make beautiful decorations. Now, I decided when I worked in Kasr-Ibrim that I needed to understand the present-day basketry traditions of Nubia better. And there are indeed a lot of parallels that you can draw between basketry that was still made in the 1960s to the 1990s. And some of those even are created today. These are small baskets. You see the scale at the top. And these were used to cover cups against dust and flies, but there were also presents that people brought to weddings. So working in Kasr-Ibrim, I was interested to work with people north of Aswan, the area where people were resettled, in so-called New Ibrim. So after spending a good while on the lakeside in the desert, I spent a couple of months in New Ibrim in a house there working with Ibrim basket makers. So this is a very simplified map of Egyptian Nubia. And this is the location of Kasr-Ibrim right here. The location of Aniba that I mentioned on the other side of the Nile, Abu Simbel, just to the south of that, and Wadi Halfa, which is traditionally the border with Sudan. Now, all these settlements were more or less recreated when the Aswan High Dam was built in Aswan, and this whole area flooded. So this is a map of New Nubia, and you recognize all those names of the old settlement in new settlements. So here we have New Ibrim, Aniba, Toshka, New Abu Simbel. And then the more northern settlements like Dhaka and the Himit, Shellal and Dabut, also north in this area, north of Aswan. So here Aswan lies in the north, here Aswan lies in the south of the map. What should strike you immediately is the big difference in size. So this is 15 kilometers. Here, this is 50 kilometers. So those settlements were much further apart in the old days than they are nowadays. And that had a lot of consequences for the culture, for the way people lived, for the way people oriented themselves, because they used to orient themselves either to Wadi Halfa or to Aswan. And now everybody had to orient themselves to Aswan, but the whole order was upside down. So in the old days, Dabut was closest to Aswan. Now Dabut was about furthest from Aswan. In the old days, weddings would take about 3 months because you had to travel a long way along the Nile to get to an area. For instance, if you were in Abu Simbel and you had to go to a wedding in Al Dakka, then you would need to travel and stay overnight. So weddings would be multiple days. That habit of having multiple days day weddings was retained in New Nubia originally. But of course now, from Abu Simbel to Dhaka is something you could easily do in an hour on a motorcycle. And if your wedding still lasts 3 days, it means that you have to feed and house a lot more people because everybody and their uncle could come to the wedding and would still stay 3 days. So people would actually go broke because of retaining the habits of old Nubia, but in a drastically changed surroundings of New Nubia. So I lived for a while in Dabut and I went to visit all of these areas around in New Nubia to work with basket makers. Now the Nubian basket makers are women for the most part, and I just want to look a little bit at what they did and how they adapted in some cases to new circumstances. Now, one of those adaptations was the use of raw materials. In old Nubia, you had these palm trees a lot. These are dome palm trees. They used to be widespread in Egypt in the distant past. For instance, in the Pharaonic period, around 1000 BC, 2000 BC, you had dome palms all over Egypt. But slowly, the climate changed and the dome palms moved. They didn't move. The palms don't walk, but they slowly retreated. They didn't occur in the north anymore. You now only find them in the south of Egypt and, of course, in Sudan. Most basketry nowadays in Egypt is made of the leaves of the date palm. And date palms are all over Egypt, all over Sudan. Very suitable for making basketry as well. Now, this is a basket from Tell el-Amarna in Egypt, and this was made of dome palm leaf. As I said, dome palms used to be quite ubiquitous in the north of Egypt in the old days. And then grass, half a grass, is used to create a bundle which is tied and sewn with strips of dome palm leaves. So this is a Middle Egyptian woman making a large basket. But nowadays in Egypt, people use date palm leaves for basket making. And this is what those baskets look like. Beautiful, regularly made baskets. The only decoration that you see are at the rim. And this is how the center is made in Egypt. A kind of knot is created, and that is then the basis on which the basket is made. Now, you can start baskets in many different ways. And the interesting thing is that it's especially in how you start a basket that you can find the hand of the producer and the traditions. And in Egypt, you might find this. There might be a leather cover sewn on the center. You might find something like this. Nubian basketry, you find this type of center, but also very often this type of center, or even the things that you see here under G and H. So Nubian traditions are quite different from the Egyptian traditions. Another very important difference is that Nubian basketry is decorated basketry. And this is the area, this is in New Nubia, where a house was created as if it was a Nubian reception room. And the baskets there are used as decoration on the walls. Also, the function of basketry in Nubia is different from the function of basketry in Egypt. In Egypt, baskets are containers. In Nubia, they can be containers, but mostly they are food covers. And that is part of a Northeast African tradition that you also find in Sudan. You find it in Ethiopia, for instance. You also see crosscraft. You see the decorated baskets and similar decorations in the wall paintings as well. And here you have a prayer mat. And that's made in a different technique, but also decorated. Now, these baskets are in an area of Egyptian Nubia where the Fadidja Nubians live. Now, to the outside world, Nubians present themselves as one people, but within Nubia, as many of you know better than I do, there are so many different groups with different languages that are really quite distinct. I will talk mostly about two groups, the Fadidja Nubians and the Kanzi Nubians. Fadidja Nubians are similar to Mahasi. Kanzi speak a quite different Nubian. So these are examples of Kanzi Nubian basketry. And as you see, these are made from different materials. Not of dome palm leaf, but the one on the left is made of washing line and the one on the right is made of cotton. And what we see, or what I saw when I was working in New Nubia, was there was a very different attitude towards thinking about the ideal materials for basketry. The Fadidja Nubian women tried to find the old materials. They wanted to use dome palm leaf, and they did everything in their power to find dome palms and to find the materials that they wanted for their basketry. The Fadidja Nubians really had trouble finding dome palm, but they really would try everything to find it. The Kanzi women just found different materials. And what it taught me was that what was essential in the Nubian basketry was not so much the raw material, the dome palm leaf, but the fact that the baskets were decorated and they would find whatever means to create these colorful baskets. And my favorite one is this one, which is actually made of candy wrappers. And then these are wrapped around the bundle materials and sewn with also artificial materials, spaced widely so you can see the colors really well. When I interviewed the women, I asked them, well, I wanted to know how much they thought tradition was important or innovation was important based on this choice of material. But I didn't want to ask for tradition and innovation. I asked, who is the better basket maker, you or your mother or your grandmother? And typically Fadidja women would tell me, my mother. She was such an amazing basket maker. She really knew the craft. She knew the traditions. And when I asked Kanzi women, many of them would say, I'm the better basket maker. I use more colors. I come up with new designs. So there seems to be a difference in how important you think the tradition is or how important you think innovation is within these two groups in New Nubia. This is another example of highly decorated basketry in the so-called imbrication method, where you use colored straw to cover the stitches that you make with the palm leaf. So decoration is essential in both traditions, in the Kanzi and the Fadidja tradition. Only the way this decoration is made and the materials especially are different. Now, if we go back to history, then we can ask ourselves, how old is this tradition of Nubian basketry? And I have the impression that it's very old. This is a scene from the tomb of Rechmira, which is New Kingdom, Egypt, which is around, say, 1500 BCE, before Common Era. And here we have a list in images of gifts from the south that were brought to Egypt. And what we see here are baskets that I have created as a bigger image here. And what these are lavishly decorated baskets, including human figures in the basketry, and all kinds of zigzags, and I'm sure they were lavishly colored. So I think this tradition of making colored basketry goes back a long way, a long time. In comparison, this is Egyptian basketry from the tomb of Ra in what is now Luxor. And like nowadays basketry, these are utilitarian baskets, carrying baskets to the left, storage baskets to the right, with no color. This is a bed from the tomb of Ra, and it has a very simple bed matting. Now, of course, the beds from Nubia are famous as well. The Angerib matting that is used to make bedding. This is from Kasr Ibrim. It's made of twisted dome palm leaf. And it's made in a beautifully complicated pattern. So here the decoration is not by using color, but by using patterns. I worked with a basket maker, a bed net maker from Darau in near New Nubia. And he showed me how he was creating this bed matting in a very similar pattern as the one I found in Kasr Ibrim. Now, these mats are more coarse and they're made of grass rope. So different material than the examples that I had from Ibrim, but it is the same tradition. The only way I could get this bed maker to make me one of these was if I ordered one, because he said people don't want these beds anymore. And if they want them, they want them made from plastic rope. To make the rope for this bed was taking a couple of days. So it was a lot of work. But I can tell you, no comparison to the plastic rope. This smells so nice, and it feels really nice to lie on these beds. And this is, you see, how he makes the edge of the bed with these wooden pegs. Another type of basketry that I found in Kasr Ibrim is this. It's called the so-called sewn plait method. And it is quite a late introduction into Egypt and Nubia, probably around the Roman period. It is a technique that is still used in Egypt. So you see that this mat maker has made a long plait and he's now sewing the plait into a basket. And he pulls these plaits inside each other, so you don't even see where one plait begins and the other ends. It seems to be one ongoing fabric. Similar technique used in Nubia. But again, in Nubia, these baskets are decorated. As you see, for instance, on this photograph of a souk, where women use these baskets for outside work, to mostly for shopping. This is also something that I found in Kasr Ibrim, made in the same technique. But here you can clearly see that they're made of different strips, different plaited strips, because the basket makers use different colors. But you see that the fabric seems to go on, but here it's clear because of those different colors that they are strips that are sewn together. A similar technique is used even nowadays for basketry or for matting in Sudan. And this prayer mat that I pointed out earlier was also made in this technique. This is a mat house used by the Ababta nomads. And I will look a little bit into their traditions as well in a moment, because they have a lot of interaction with the Nubians from the Nile Valley. Of course, we have the wonderful Nubian Museum in Aswan, and this has ancient finds, archaeological finds, but also exhibits that show life in Nubia in the past, in the 1960s. A reconstruction of houses, a reconstruction of a madrasa, a school, a Quran school, where all the kids sit on the type of mats that I just showed you. You also see the decoration of the walls, plates being used, as well as the baskets, but the baskets are used inside, the plates are used outside. And you see here two women making these colored plates. Well, they're not real women. They are exhibits. So we have Kasr Ibrim and New Ibrim on both sides of Aswan. And I want to talk a little bit about another excavation that I was involved in Berenike on the Red Sea coast. This was an excavation from the Roman period, where we excavated a harbor town for trade between India and Rome that went through Egypt. So the ships would land in Berenike, and then things were brought overland to Edfu, nowadays Edfu, just north of New Ibrim. We worked there with the Ababta nomads, who live in this whole area between the Red Sea and the Nile Valley. And here you see a woman outside her house, and that house is made of similar mats as I've shown you before. And I worked with the Ababta women to build one of those houses. Now, if we do archaeology, we have a lot to learn from the people who are living in the same region nowadays. So that is why I went to work in the modern day Nubian villages, but also worked with the Ababta. So here we see the men who collect wood from bushes and trees in the Eastern Desert. They were very careful with selecting those things that wouldn't damage the environment. Of course, forked sticks are extremely important if you want to build something from wood. Here he's sharpening his axe. And this is basically everything you need for a mat house, a Beit Burush, in the Eastern Desert. So first you dig a hole for your standers. Then you put the uprights and you tie the roof beams, and everything is tied together with this kind of rope made of sheep's wool and goat hair. And you don't even use one single nail to create these houses. Then you put woolen carpets on the inside, and then you cover the entire thing with those mats made of sewn plates. Again, everything is just put together without using nails or metal or anything. So these are bits of palm branch that are sharpened and used as needles to stick bits together. And here you have your house complete. Here in this light, you can actually see the different strips of palm leaf. And this is the front of the house. Now, in the 1920s, there was an Egyptologist and who was also a botanist who worked with the Ababta and the Nubians. And he saw the Ababta as being a kind of predecessors or inheritors of ancient Egypt. He pointed out that we know that in ancient Egypt, people used headrests, and so do the Ababta. This is one that I collected for a collection that I made together with the Ababta in Berenike. Now, headrests are, of course, used widely still in East Africa. So it's no surprise that the Ababta used them. But what it teaches you is that as Egyptologists, we need to use much, we need to look much broader than just Egypt. We need to look south. And that has been done not nearly enough. And if we look south, we shouldn't look only at trade contacts or ancient colonialism. We should look at this cultural strata, this cultural continuum that is Northeast Africa. Another thing that Keimer pointed out was the hair. Ancient Egyptians plaited their hair in beautiful plait patterns. And so do the Ibabte, but so do Sudanese women, so do Ethiopian women. So again, we have this cultural continuum that has changes because hairstyles change, but they also have very strong traditions. So we need to look both at change and at continuation to understand how this cultural continuum works. Now, in Berenike, we worked with a lot of Ababte that didn't come just from the surroundings of Berenike, but also from Wadi Harit. And Wadi Harit is an Ababte settlement in the same region as New Nubia. And there's a lot of interaction between the inhabitants of Wadi Harit as well as the inhabitants of the Eastern Desert and the Nubians that have resettled in New Nubia. But in history, also the Nubians who were settled in all of Egyptian Nubia and Sudanese Nubia. So there's this constant interaction and exchange between people who live in the desert and the people who live along the Nile, in the Nile Valley. With the Ababte, and especially those guys from Wadi Harit, we worked on collecting present-day Ababte material culture. And we recorded everything to write down everything we still knew about this area. For instance, the swords, that was an important part of Ababte culture, and the scabbards. When I asked the Ababte what was the most important in their material culture, they said, everything we need to make coffee, the jabana. Because every pot of coffee is made fresh, by roasting the beans, by then stamping the beans in a mortar and pestle, and then creating coffee in this special coffee pot, the jabana. This is what you need to make coffee. There's a whole bunch of material culture, of paraphernalia to create coffee, from the roasting to the fan that you need to fan the fire, to the mortar and pestle, something to put the special coffee pot on, something to transport your cups, something to transport your jabana, a water container, something to put out the cups. And if an Ababte goes into the desert, he takes or she takes a goat skin with all of this stuff. And for a nomadic population, that's a lot of stuff to carry. What that tells you is that this is indeed essential in culture, because it would be much easier to take a pot of Nescafe, of course, but that's not the point. The second thing that needed to be collected was everything that goes on a camel. And an Ababte camel is decorated with loads of tassels and decorations that all have their specific name. And that's also central in the culture. What I forgot to say was, of course, that the jabana is, again, something that you find in Sudan and in Ethiopia as much as you find it in the south of Egypt. So this is one of the camel bags that are made by the Ababte women. This is actually the woman who made this gorgeous goat hair and cotton decorated camel bag. And this is the wedding saddle, because I asked the men what they wanted us to collect, and they came up with the camel and the coffee. But the women said, but we need a wedding saddle. And these are beautiful things that are decorated with cowrie shells. We also asked the man who was working with us to express how they saw about the life, and they came up with these beautiful drawings, which shows all the essentials, not just what goes on a camel, but also what people wear, the comb that they wear in their hair, and a shield and sword. Because that, again, is part, luckily, not anymore of fighting, but of dancing nowadays. Although in the tradition, it goes back to desert life and the dangers of desert life. Wild animals, such as this leopard, but also other human beings who usually are more dangerous than the wild animals. So Abab'te life is symbolized by the Jabana and by camel. But of course, those are symbols from a much richer culture and a culture that is changing all the time, that is not static. And that's an important thing to keep in mind. We can find parallels between ancient Egypt and ancient Nubia and present day culture. And it's good to remember that culture, but that doesn't mean that we should long for that culture that didn't have schools, that didn't have hospitals, that had a lot of good things, but also a lot of difficulties. Now, the exchange between Abab'te and Nubians is something that I'm very interested in. And actually, one of my grad students is doing a project on this. Because the Abab'te would go into the Nile Valley to help Nubians with at harvest time, for instance, in exchange for part of the harvest, which they could then take back into the desert to subsist on. So this whole exchange is very important and has always been very important through history. And it's important to see this as an exchange of differences, but also as a celebration of similarities and of collaboration. And that is what I love about Nubia Fest. It is a celebration. It is a remembering of culture, of traditions, but also a celebration of what we still know, what we can still understand, and what we can come to understand through research, such as archaeological research, and such as comparing archaeology with present day remains. So with that, I want to thank you and open it up for questions. And I'm now going to stop sharing my screen. And see if I can get rid of this image so I can see you again. Okay. So we have a remark from Behane Fesha, who says, great. And then Solange, hi Solange. How much for the handwoven angerib that you bought in Darau? Oh dear, it's a while ago. And by the way, I also want to say that I have images of both women making a basket and of the guy in Darau making this bed it's part of a video that's part of a book on basketry, and I can provide the link to that video so you can have a look at that. Or if there's time, I can show little bits of it. Solange, I think I paid at that time, but this is in the 1990s, 50 Egyptian pounds. And that was both for the bed and the work that goes into making the bed matting. Now, I was a student, so for me, that was not an inconsiderable sum. Of course, it's nothing for the amount of work that goes into creating this bed. The work, the knowledge, just the effort. So, and I had that bed in my house a long time. But when I was moving to the United States, I had to leave it behind because it was completely infested with woodworm. And I couldn't get it I couldn't get it fixed in time before my move. So with pain in my heart, I left it behind in Egypt. And I would love to find another mat maker who could make me one. Because that knowledge is we're losing that as well. Iman says, they have so many similarities with Afar groups. Yes, Iman, and that's exactly what I mean with cultural continuum. There is so much that is similar. And on the other hand, there's so much of the very own character of different groups, as I showed in the difference between the Nubia and the Fadidja, who both thought that decorated basketry is important, but the one group says it's important, so we adhere to tradition. The other group says it's important, so we are going to innovate and find different colors. So we have to look at both these continuations and also look at the agency of groups, the agency, how people do things on their own way. We could look at, or I'd be happy to answer some other questions. If there's things you recognize from your grandmother or things that are different, let me know. I would love to learn more. We can look at the photos. You mean at the video? I can play a little bit of video, both of the Nubian woman and the basket maker. And then I have to share my screen again. So let's see if I can show my other screen. So I'll run forward because it has a lot of the Egyptian basketry. I'm running through this. This is Middle Egypt. This is also Middle Egypt. As you see, she's making basketry that is not decorated. But then we get to Nubia. And in the meantime, I don't think you hear sound. There isn't a lot of sound, but I can answer questions in the meantime. So here you see a plaited center and a beautifully decorated Fadidja basket made of dome palm, dyed dome palm. And now we're going over to one of the older women. And she is starting a basket. So she's making this plaited center of the basket. It was clear to me when I was here that the younger women weren't nearly as good as creating this as the older women. By the way, at her knee, you see one of those plaited strips. So she can do both types of basketry. That time, there was also a difference between the two Nubian groups in the kind of tube they wear. So as you see, she's wearing a black tube. Other villages, the women all were wearing white tubes. Here you see the starts of baskets are always the most difficult. So she makes two, one on top of the other. And this is a technique that you also can use for decorations. If you can just keep going. all of this material has to be made wet, because otherwise it would break. So now she's starting the bundle of a curled basket. She splits the dom pom leaf, and the stuff that she's using for the center, for the coil, are shredded parts of the sword on which the dates grow on a date palm leaf. It's very stiff material. And if you don't make it wet, it will break. As you see, she doesn't use a needle. She uses an awl to make a little hole. And she makes incredibly fine stitches. It's beautiful work. So she first makes the hole, and then she uses the pointy bit of the palm leaf strip. She pulls that through. Now, to make one of those big baskets that you just saw is a week of work. And that's almost full time. And if you see for what kind of prices these baskets are sold, then it pains my heart. This is so much work and such beautiful work that these things should, that they're worth hundreds of dollars if you wanted to put a money value to it. So now she was wetting her fingers because it was getting a bit dry. So this symbol of the little hammer that you see, I'm using in the video to show the use of instruments, to show the difference between the awl. There's a whole set of symbols in the videos. And the description, there's a link between the video and the book. And the book and video are freely downloadable. And I will put the link to that in the chat. I can't look it up now because both my screens are in use. Now, the difference between the young woman making this, the woman in the background, and the older woman is that the younger woman is less skilled. She's much more hasty. She works faster, but a lot less precise. The older woman just keeps going. She has this very calm, rhythmic way of working. So now we're a bit further, and she's working in three colors, a purple, a red, and a white. And I discern active and passive strands. So passive is what she handles, what she works with. Sorry, that's the active. The passive is what she isn't touching as much. So the bundle is passive, and the colors that she doesn't use at the moment are passive elements. And in a moment, she'll change color. So she's now using white. And now she puts the white parallel to the bundle, and she brings the red to the fore. And the purple is also parallel to the bundle. She doesn't use that at the moment. And that's also the way if one of those leaves is exhausted, if she needs to put in a new one, she just lets the little end run parallel with the bundle material. So you don't see it anymore. Usually one side of the basket looks better than the other side. So the side that she has towards herself looks more regular than the side that's away from where she's looking. Now she needs to add to the bundle. So she splits the jade. what you see with a lot of these crafts is that is that the whole body is involved. A lot of basket makers work, they use their teeth, their hand, their feet to keep things in balance. And then a comment from Iman to Solange. I see some affinities with the Ivory Coast sweet grass basketry continued by the Gula Gishi. Truly amazing, almost as if embedded into the genetic memory. We have to be a bit careful there, because if you look at American Indian basketry, that has great similarities as well. So it's also some of the techniques just automatically lead someone to do things in a certain way. I'm going to go quickly through this one to get to the bed maker. Just show you how the twining is done. Because if you see a ready-made technique, then it's very difficult to just reconstruct how it's made. So looking at modern-day basket makers is really, really useful. Okay, here we go to the bed matting. So this is one of the bed mats from Kasser Ibrahim. This one is also made with string. And I saw this bed on the market, and that's how I found the mat maker. So he has created the string beforehand. It's made of halva grass. And that's what the little symbol of the palm tree indicates, that comes up when the video really shows clearly the properties of the material. So now he's thinning out the end of a rope to link it to another bit of rope that's also been thinned out, so that he doesn't get a very thick bubble in his rope. And he is and Dima says, I have a video of the halva grass making the strings and rope. That would be great if you could share that. I have videos of a basket maker from Middle Egypt doing it, but not a basket maker from Nubia. And that method of rolling the rope is beautiful. And it looks so easy, but I've tried all these techniques. I've apprenticed with all these basket makers. They usually fall over laughing if they see me trying these things, because it's not easy at all. And you have to have not just the right movement, but also the callus to do it. Now you can imagine how long it takes to make enough rope for the entire bed. If you see this video after you've seen the photographs in my presentation, then it's also clear that a video so much better conveys how the technique works, but also what the movements are like. Dima, we are 3 minutes from 12. This will take, I think, about 10 minutes. Tell me when we have to stop. It's okay, Dima said. Keep going. Okay, that's easy. He's doing all the hard work. So it's really interesting to see how he makes the edge. And he basically weaves two strands at the same time. So he makes this loop, puts it through the previous loop, and now he's going to do the weft, indicating to me that he's now changing direction. So he's weaving two strands at the same time because he is working with loops rather than with single threads. Otherwise, he has to pull through the entire length of rope all the time. And every time I think of the video work that I've done, I think we should be doing this so much more, because all of these techniques are dying out or changing. He needed a nice smooth peg from the foot of the bed. So he uses these pegs for a lot of different things. And that's important for us archaeologists to see as well, because if we find wooden pegs, we have no idea what they're used for. And from the use marks, the use wear that we find on ethnographic examples, that will actually help us to explain things in archaeology. So he weaves this in a twill pattern. He goes two further. He loops the loop through the previous loop and then uses the peg to make sure it doesn't unravel. And he has laid out the rope all the way in the street. Do you see it lying there? Because otherwise it would become one big tangle. And these are the other bunches of rope that are ready to be used. And of course, he needs to make sure that the bed matting is tightly woven. So apart from just pulling it, he also beads it. In the meantime, his colleague has found a very comfortable place to sit on. And that's sort of funny, because you would think it would disturb the tension of the string in the frame. But apparently he's not bothered by that. Now, any basketry technique, and actually most craft techniques anyway, have a lot of repetitive actions. You have to do the same thing all the time. Except when you have a break, when you hit your... Ah, maybe he was bothered by the guy sitting on his bed. Ah, now he says, give me a hand. Because now we need to pull through the entire rope. And why is that? Because he's going to change the pattern. So he has the loops coming from the other side. You'll see that in a moment. So now he's going to work from the other side. And he checks whether that change is in the right place, because he wants to make a balanced number of changes in the pattern. And again, we have passive and active elements. The passive is the warp. The active is the weft. Now, I always say that apprenticeship includes building endurance, and you can see here why that's important. He is bending over for hours to be able to make this matting. So just the muscle power that is needed to be able to do that is enormous. So here you see the change in direction. So the V is going the other way. Now we're getting near the end. There's a lot less space. And now he uses actually one of those pegs to help beating the weave more tightly. Because he doesn't have space to do it with the big stick. So here you see the full pattern. And this is the very end. It pulls the string through the last loops. What he has at the header are ropes with which you can strengthen and tighten the bed, because of course after a while it might sag a little bit, and in this way you can keep it tight. Okay, he's almost done. And that's it. Okay, well, thank you for listening. And I think we have another presentation coming up. Let's stay in touch. It was a pleasure.